clouds, shining like the sun. Happy trumpet calls, lift your voice. It's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Good morning and welcome to worship at Zion Lutheran Church in Buffalo, Minnesota. Let me give you a couple of announcements about things that are coming up in the life of our congregation. First of all, next Tuesday, July 21st, the Women's Summer Bible Study will begin. You can find details about that on our church website. And then on July 27th, that's a Monday, the last Monday of July, we'll be having our traditional ice cream social at our Marysville Country Church. Ice cream will be individually wrapped ice cream treats, a variety of them, and we'll start that at 6:30, and then at 7 o'clock, we will have a hymn sing outside. The sanctuary at Marysville is too small to really get people in, and so join us for a hymn sing and ice cream treats. That's Monday, July 27th. And then finally, we will be celebrating communion as part of our worship the first weekend of August. And for those students that have gone through our communion class and will be receiving communion, you'll be participating in any one of those services that you would like. All three of our services, the in-sanctuary, online, and outdoor drive-in worship services, will be celebrating communion that day. There are other announcements. Please make yourself aware of what's coming up in the life of our church, and welcome to worship.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation.
Amen.
Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hopes in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Like a tree planted by the water, we
into the world. We're reaching out to show them who you are.
So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you known. We lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Faithful God, most merciful Judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion. By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into the living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized into one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined to God's mission for the life of the world. Parents and sponsors, as you bring Rutger Allen to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with these responsibilities: to live with him among God's faithful people, to bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and to nurture him in faith and prayer so that he may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help Rutger Allen grow in the Christian faith in life? If so, reply with, I do.
I do.
People of God and all of those who are gathered together, do you promise to support Rutger Allen and pray for him and his new life in Christ? If so, reply with, we do.
We do.
Now we join together in our profession of faith. Parents, sponsors, all those gathered here, I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? If so, say, I renounce them.
I renounce them.
Now we will use the words of the Apostles' Creed answering these questions. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rutger Allen, you are baptized in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to eternal life. Lord God, sustain Rutger Allen with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Rutger Allen, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Let your light so shine before all people that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Amen.
The cross of Christ is an important symbol. On behalf of our congregation, we give you this handmade cross as a remembrance of three things: of this day, of baptism, and of Christ's command, take up your cross and follow me. Through baptism, God has made you a member of the priesthood we all share in Christ Jesus, that we may proclaim the praise of God and bear his creative and redeeming word to all people. Thank you.
Now I ask everyone to please join me in welcoming Rutger into God's family and into our Zion family.
We welcome you, Rutger, into the body of Christ and into the mission we share, to share Christ's word, strengthen faith, and serve those in need.
Now let's welcome with a good round of applause.
Hey, good morning, Zion kids. We are here this morning for our children's message, and we're going to dig into the scripture that Pastor Ted is going to read for us in just a little while. It says, "What does God require of us but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God?" So we have a little bit of an experiment or an example that we are going to give here. I have a glass jar here full of water. That's all that's in it right now. And this is kind of like our world. Pretty simple, lots going on in there, but just kind of simple. And then God's love comes into our world. We're going to add some food coloring here. Let me shake it up for us so we can get a good red water here. And God's love comes into the world in just one man, right? When Jesus came into the world. But then the whole world became loved by God. So now we have this world that is full of God's love. But we as people sort of struggle with that, of what does that mean? How do we want to continue to love? And so our world is going along fairly easily, and then God says, I want you to walk humbly with me. So when we walk humbly, means that we have the ability to do things with God, that we're kind of friends with God, right? But we also respect God and know God is God, and that we shouldn't be thinking that we are God. But God asks us to walk next to him. And so we have some oil here. I know, a big jug. It's what happens when you go into the kitchen at Zion. We're going to put just a little bit of oil in our jar here. And this represents who we are now walking with God. I'm not sure if we're going to be able to see this. Okay. Angela's giving me the thumbs up that it's going to be okay. So now we have ourselves in our jar here, and we're kind of just floating on the top, hanging out. Maybe we put it over here. You can see it. But what happens if we shake ourselves up and we get in a really good relationship with God? Did that work? Not really. We're just sort of floating back up to the top again, and we're pretending that we're walking pretty closely with God, but we're just kind of walking next to God. We're not really integrated with God and having God as a whole part of our lives like God's love is in the whole world. So we have one more ingredient that we're going to add. We're going to add some dish soap. This reminds us that in that phrase from Micah 6:8, it says that we need to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with our God. Because we use dish soap for lots of things, right? Including doing dishes. What does doing dishes do for us? It means that the dishes that we have get to be used again, and they get to be used what they were created to do, right? We don't just throw dishes away after we've used them once. We use some dish soap, and we make sure that we are good and clean and that we can do it again. So now we have our water. We're sitting here floating on the top, kind of with God, kind of separate. Now we're going to add some of this stuff that helps us to be who we were created to be. Because God has created us to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with our God. So now when we add that ingredient and we do all three of those things, we get all mixed up. And we are truly walking with God and integrated God into all parts of our lives. And so we can try to do one or two, but it's when we do all three that we know we are being who God created us to be, to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with our God. Will you pray with me? Repeat after me. Say, "Dear God, we thank you and praise you that you have told us how to live. Help us every day to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. We pray this in your Son's name." And all God's children said, Amen.
So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain, 'cause I'm not who I used to be. Because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, 'cause his day is long and gone. Because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and I hope that will carry. These heavy chains, wipe away every stain, 'cause I'm not who I used to be. Oh God, I'm not who I used to be. Jesus, I'm not who I used to be.
Our scripture reading for today comes from the book of Micah, Micah 6:8. The other passage from Exodus, I'm going to read in the middle of my passage, so please follow along as I read it out loud. He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. I heard about a story, it was a story about a concert that took place in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And one of the pieces the orchestra was going to play had a flute solo that was to come from off stage. The person playing the flute was not going to be able to see the conductor, so they had practiced the timing. They had everything just right. They wanted the flute to sound like it was far in the distance. So when the time came, when that piece was being played, the flute player came in just perfect. The sound was just what they had wanted for that particular piece. And as the flute player was going on, suddenly, off stage, there was this loud shriek, and the flute stopped. Well, of course, the orchestra kept going. And as soon as they were done with the concert, the conductor went straight to the flute player and was quite upset. And before the conductor got there, the flute player said, "Just wait, just wait, just wait. Listen to me first. I came in exactly how we practiced, right? And it was just going along perfectly well, just what was expected of me. But then all of a sudden, one of the stagehands came running over and grabbed my flute and said, 'Be quiet, you idiot. Don't you know there's a concert going on here?'" And I think that's sort of like life for all of us. We're going along, doing what we think is expected, what we're supposed to be doing, and suddenly life gets turned upside down. And I think that's true especially in our life of faith. We go along doing what we think God expects of us, what God wants from us, and then we get new information, or we have some sort of a new experience, or we have this new sense of call on our lives. And suddenly, we're not at all sure what's expected of us, what we're supposed to do. And we find ourselves asking, well, what really is expected of me? What does God want from me? In today's passage of Scripture, coming from the Old Testament, Micah was one of the prophets that God spoke through to the people of Israel. And Micah spoke on behalf sometimes of the poor farmers who were being taken advantage of by the wealthier landowners, and often spoke on their behalf to the landowners or to the nation of Israel. And over the course of time, Israel had fallen far away from what God had expected of them, what God had asked of them to do, the covenant relationship that God had with the nation of Israel. So far away had they fallen that they didn't even recognize their own sin. They didn't even realize that they were trusting in things other than God. And in that particular time of history, there were other nations from around them that were constantly coming after Israel, trying to defeat them and to take over the land. And Israel kept trusting in other things rather than following the covenant with God. And so in this particular part of the story from Micah, Micah is speaking to the whole nation about following God and what God expects of them, what God is asking of them. And the people want it easy. They want to just do something for God. You know, make a sacrifice. Okay, God, I'm just going to sacrifice a lamb or sacrifice a bull. Or we just want to observe all the festivals you've told us to observe. But God wants their heart. God wants their whole life. God wants their every day. And so Micah spoke these words to the whole nation of Israel. Before this comes, I don't want your festivals. I don't want your sacrifices. I don't want the incense. What I want from you, and then comes this passage of Scripture. God speaks through the prophet. What I want from you is for you to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. God wants their whole life. And I think this passage speaks to us today as well. You know, it's easy for us to give some sort of a cash donation to God's mission in this world. It's easier than giving our heart, soul, mind, and strength, isn't it? It's easier to just go to church every single Sunday. It'd be easier to be there with without exception every Sunday in church than to give our heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's what Micah was saying. God wants your heart and mind. God wants your life. God wants your every day. And the way God wants it is for you and me to simply do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. So I just want to take those three things one at a time, but I want to start with kindness. Isn't kindness, showing kindness, doing kind deeds for other people, probably the most basic element of our Christian faith? Jesus said we should treat other people the way we want to be treated. Do to others as we would like them to do to us. I read a quote by one of the famous forefathers in the Quaker tradition. And that forefather said this: I expect to pass through life but once. If therefore there be any kindness I can show, or any good thing I can do to my fellow being, let me do it now, and not defer or neglect it, as I shall not pass this way again. The passage of Scripture that comes from Exodus chapter 23, I think, pushes us on towards kindness, and then eventually it pushes us past kindness to justice. Here it is, Exodus 23, 1 through 9. You shall not spread a false report. You shall not join hands with the wicked to act as a malicious witness. You shall not follow a majority in wrongdoing. When you hear witness, when you bear witness in a lawsuit, you shall not side with the majority so as to pervert justice, nor shall you be partial to the poor in a lawsuit. When you come upon your enemy's ox or donkey going astray, you shall bring it back. When you see the donkey of one who hates you lying under its... When you see the donkey of one who hates you lying under its burden, and you would hold back from setting it free, you must help and set it free. You shall not pervert the justice due to your poor in their lawsuits. Keep far from a false charge, and do not kill the innocent and those in the right, for I will not acquit the guilty. You shall take no bribe, for a bribe blinds the officials and subverts the cause of those who are in the right. You shall not oppress a resident alien. You know the heart of an alien, for you were aliens in the land of Egypt. Exodus chapter 23 says there really is no limit to our kindness. In fact, it pushes us beyond kindness and tells us something about judgment, justice. I've noticed that in our confirmation classes, Pastor Suzi talks about this very concept. She says, she condenses it down to one thing, well, two things. Love God, love others. Oftentimes she brings the kids to that point. It's really about this, loving God and loving other people. Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Kindness. Doing good for those around us is one of the most basic tenets of our Christian faith. Which brings us to justice. There's kindness, Micah says, love kindness, and Micah says, do justice. Justice is a much larger issue and more complicated. Kindness is an individual act, like the Good Samaritan, the story Jesus told, just stopping to help the person who's in need on the side of the road. But justice is a little different. Justice is working toward all people being treated the way we ourselves want to be treated. Abraham Lincoln once saw a young slave girl being sold. She was being taken away from her family. And as he watched it, Abraham Lincoln could see the terror in her eyes and hear the fear in her tears as she was ripped from her family, sold, and taken away. And Abraham Lincoln said to himself that day, this must stop. And he dedicated his life to ending slavery. Kindness would have been to buy her and set her free. Justice is eliminating slavery. God calls us beyond kindness and calls us to justice, to making sure all people are treated the way we ourselves want to be treated. And then finally, walk humbly with your God. John Killinger is a pastor who's written a number of books, stories, but also theology and commentary on the contemporary church. But John Killinger told a story that had appeared in the Atlantic Monthly years ago. And the story was about those days in the history of our country where you had the big cattle drives going across country to the nearest big railway station where they were then shipped off to slaughtering houses. And in that whole effort, there were always these steers that were rambunctious and hard to control, and they were wild and bucking and running. And one of the little tricks they had was to tie a burro and a steer together, close enough that they felt each other, but far enough away that the burro didn't get killed. They'd tie them together, and then they would watch the steer dragging that burro off, the steer kicking and bucking and running, and that little burro being dragged along, flown all over, almost like a kite. And they would just watch it go away and let it be. And then inevitably, a few days later, they would see the burro leading the steer back home. I think walking humbly with God is something like that burro. We're just plain determined to do what God calls us to do. Not paying attention to all of the other stuff that's going on around us. We're just committed to doing justice, loving kindness, and walking with God. And that determination and commitment to follow God faithfully with all we are and all we do gets things done in our world. The nation of Israel, when these words from Micah came to them, they were impatient. They were impatient with God. They were demanding of God. And they had this attitude towards God that you owe us. God, you should come and save us from all of these nations that are around here. And the prophet Micah, in a way, said to them, you need to simply let God be God. And you walk humbly with God as God. And the way that came out to the people was this. God has shown you what God wants you to do. And it's simply this. Do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. Let's pray. Good and gracious Lord, we can go our own way so easily. We can look around us at the things that are going on in the world and decide to take care of ourselves and our loved ones and to be unaware of all of the things around us. God, help us to practice kindness. But help us go beyond kindness and to live our lives in a way that reflects a desire that all people would be treated the way we want ourselves to be treated. And then, God, help us to live life in a way that you're able to be who you are in our lives. Help us not to become presumptive, not to become demanding or expect everything from you, but help us do what you expect and call us to do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Call for songs of loudest praise, while the whole confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit. We pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Good and loving God, your prophet Micah reminded the people that you call us to do justice, practice kindness, and walk humbly with you. We ask for guidance, wisdom, strength, and compassion to answer that call and follow your will for our lives. Help us as individuals and together as your church throughout the world to be diligent in our witness to your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all goodness, we thank you and praise you for all the blessings you give us each day. Help us remember to acknowledge the many ways you give us our daily bread and provide for our needs. Bless the people who work to nourish us and protect us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the nations, teach us your ways, that justice, kindness, and peace may reign across the globe. Mend the fabric of the human family torn apart by dissension, hatred, and war. Raise up leaders dedicated to working in harmony with one another, and guide us all by your grace and steadfast love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of hope, you walk with those who suffer and weep with the brokenhearted. Open our eyes, ears, and hearts to our sisters and brothers who are lonely and abandoned, who feel marginalized or trapped by despair, and all who are broken in mind, body, or spirit. Use us as ministers of your presence to those in need in our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come,
your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Now receive the benediction. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor height, nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love.
Amen.
And now we go into our daily lives with all we are and all we do.
We will trust, live, and serve Christ Jesus our Lord.
Woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something?
I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist to heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did.
Yeah, I created.
To do something. I'm so tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. Live like angels of apathy, we tell ourselves it's all right, somebody else will do something.
Sick and tired, life with no desire. I don't want to flame, I want a fire. I want to be the one who stands up and says, I'm gonna do something. If not us, then who? If not me and you right now, it's time for us to do something. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Oh, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. We are the salt of the earth, we are sitting on a hill. Shine, 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 shine. We're never gonna change the world by standing still. No, we won't stand still. Oh, if not us, then who? If not me and you right now, it's time for us to do something. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Oh, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something.